Let me tell you a little bit about what happens in an NLP practitioner. Some of the skills we do, and it's funny because I just came from this training on Thursday we ended. It was a 7-day training in Orange County, California. And I didn't want to leave, you know. We had it was just the most amazing training. I had a group full of people there that, what I saw them go through, the transformation that happened, I can't even describe. You have to go through it yourself. I cannot describe it. I was so lit up, I knew that's why I'm here. You know, people are going through process after process after process, not only doing it with themselves, but learning how to do this with others and how to change other people's lives. But even though they came for other people, first you do it on yourself. And when they go through those processes, something's really amazing. So some of the first things we learn are observation and rapport skills. We learn observation skills like Milton Erickson had. The kind of observation when you can see the beating of the pulse of somebody's right ankle change tempo. Learning with sensory acuity, how to observe so acutely that you can see subtle shifts, which you can use everywhere, in relationships, in business, in sales, in therapy. We also learn rapport skills. We have a really cool exercise we do in NLP, which basically means we get into rapport with somebody in such a strong way that within moments, we literally feel the feelings that person feels. About 80% of the room feels the feelings the other person feels, and usually about a third of the room actually sees somebody something that the other person sees. They'll actually see a vision or get a word, see a person. It's spooky. It's really, really cool. But that's what happens when you can get in that close of rapport. So if you can do that in class, imagine what you can do out in the real world when it's possible. We teach the skills of anchoring. If we have time tomorrow, I'm going to take you through my process of creating the champion state, and that's a process of anchoring. I want you to feel how powerful it is and why you want this. Anchoring is something that we didn't really touch upon yet, but it's a process where, like with Pavlov's dogs, you can have an external trigger or an internal trigger that will anchor you to a certain feeling, a certain state. And we have negative anchors that we usually don't want, and we have positive anchors, ones we do want. What happens normally is people don't choose their anchors. They just have unconscious anchors that happen automatically. The kind of thing where, you know, you hear a song on the radio during a breakup or falling in love from years ago and it takes you back to that moment right then, that's an anchor. Usually it happens automatically. Here we teach you how to collapse and eliminate the negative anchors for negative emotions and how to create positive resource anchors for ones that you want, as well as a few different anchoring exercises that are very powerful. You learn how to communicate so they hear you. How many times have, you know, maybe you're in an argument or something, and they just go, "I just don't see what you mean, I don't get this." And you say, "Well, you're just not listening, what the heck's your problem?" And two people, for some reason, just keep missing each other. Well, from Virginia Satir, we understand that people think differently. What Virginia did to be so magical and so popular was she would take people and she would literally translate by their representational systems. She learned that a husband was visual and a wife was auditory or kinesthetic, and she would translate between what their words were. So you can learn to use predicates in certain words and certain phraseology and a certain tonality that will match that person's representational systems so much that they'll hear exactly what you mean. And again, this goes everywhere. This goes for sales. This goes for family, for loved ones, for spouses, for kids, for trainings, for friends, for yourself. And I wish we had time to get into all this strategies. Strategies are extremely powerful. We spent an entire day on strategies. Strategies, in a nutshell, are the recipes that we use in our internal process to do anything we do. Every time, think about this, every time you make a decision, you go through a certain internal process, which is the same every time you make a decision. Every time. Every time we get motivated to do something, like, for instance, you want to get motivated to buy a new car, you go through an internal process, which is the same every time you get motivated. You go through a different process to make a decision, and a different process to feel good about it afterwards, your reassurance strategy. When we learn what people's strategies are and what our own strategies are, we can fire them off, we can utilize them to get the results we want. And then we have a learning strategies. We also do spelling strategies. There's particular processes we go through in order to learn, and in order to be a good or bad speller. Here's what's interesting. Bad spellers aren't born, they're made. They have bad strategies. if you know anybody, especially children, adults it works great on. This last week I did a spelling strategy on a 27-year-old. We also did one on a 55-year-old. It worked beautifully. All of a sudden, for the first time in their life, they're spelling the word success forwards, backwards, and feeling great about it in their mind's eye. When in the past, there was no way they'd be able to do that. You know, all we did was interrupt and change their strategies around. Huge, huge shift. Brent said that, I mean, that was worth it in and of itself. That was worth the entire training just to let go of the belief that he was a bad speller. Is anybody in sales in any way? Does anybody ever talk to another human being? Good, you're all in sales. We're always selling, right? Whether we think so or not, we're always selling, even if it's just our ideas to someone else. Even if it's just your kid to take out the trash, we're always selling something. So whether you're doing it for money compensation or whether you're doing it just because you're a human being, we teach a five-step sales process, which was modeled from some of the best salesmen in the world. You know, the Tommy Hopkins, the Zig Ziglars, some of the best people in the world that are spelling, that are sales strategists. We've modeled this through NLP and found out what the best process is and created a simple five-step sales process that incorporates all of it. And in the end, someone can't help but buy whatever it is you want to sell. Especially if it's a win-win, that's what we teach. It's not about manipulating, it's about having a win-win. With any other training, you probably get all this. With our training, we also teach time techniques. We touched on this earlier. We teach you how you store time. If you're always running 5 or 10 minutes late to everything, we'll teach you how to be on time, if that's what you want. If you're always worried about your watch, and you can never enjoy the moment, we can teach you how to be in the moment. That'll happen with a 5-minute exercise, believe it or don't. We go through the process of eliminating all negative emotions, limiting decisions, limiting beliefs, and putting goals into your future in such a way. This is really cool because we've all done goal setting at some point, but this is actually putting goals into your future so that they will actualize without even having to work at it. You'll still do the actions, but the actions will just line themselves up for you. Your unconscious mind will drive you directly to your goal in that time frame. It's extremely powerful. We had a director come through class who for 2 years he was trying to get the fundraising for a real simple independent film. He needed to raise $50,000. And he came at that point after 2 years trying and he was ready to give up. And we said, you know, well, what are you thinking about? And once we went through setting the goal in the future, you know, he said, you know, we said, when do you want to do this? And he said, how about April 1st? And I said, well, isn't that next week? Do you think that's very possible? And he goes, probably not. I said, okay, well, let's get something more probable. When do you know you can get the money by? He said, well, October. I know I can get it by October. Good. This was back in March. So we said, okay, could you get it sooner than that? He said, well, yeah, probably. So anyway, we figured out when the goal would be, set it. Within 45 days, no, less than that, it was like less than 30 days, literally it just dropped in his lap. The opportunity showed up, and I believe it was because his unconscious mind guided him to that right opportunity. And somebody came and said, yeah, I'd love to invest in your movie. Can I write you a check? And literally attracted that money just like that, and I believe he attributed it to the time techniques. So huge. To him, it was worth $50,000 right then. We also teach Ericksonian hypnosis, or what we call conversational hypnosis. See, this weekend we're learning the 8-step Krasner method, right? Krasner method's great. It works great for smoking, for basic weight loss, for basic pain control. But when you get into conversational hypnosis, this is where you're hypnotizing people and they don't even know what's happening. You know, you're having a conversation, and before you know it, they're in a light trance, and you're helping them to change now, all through language patterns. We studied Milton Erickson and the language patterns he would use in everyday life, and he would use with his clients.